To the month of greatness.
Amen.
That tells me that God has great things in store for us.
Amen.
And we all shall be partakers Amen. Of God's greatness this month.
Amen.
Who taught the song where to stand in the morning? Who told the ocean you can only come this far, and who showed the moon where to hide till the end? Who dwells alone can catch a falling star?
Redeemed us from
from the pit of hell. He has redeemed you and I from the powers of Satan. He has redeemed us from wicked ones. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has made us free. Hallelujah. From the law of sin and death. Nothing should disturb you from your sleep. For the devil does not have the power to kill you. Devil no power over you. In the name of Jesus. If you believe that, say, I believe that. He just said something. He said, Pharaoh is just a noise. His time appointed has expired.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Don't listen to the noise. It's just a noise. God is in control. Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. I'm so happy to know that God that has vindicated you despite all the odds. I just love that God that the devil cannot do you any harm. I'm trying to remember that song. It said, where the devil can do me no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm. Where the devil can do me no harm. What's the song again? I'm going to hide right under the rock. Is it? I'm going to hide right under the rock. I'm going to hide right under the rock. Where the devil can do me no harm. Sing it with me. No harm, no harm, no harm, no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm, no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm. Where the devil can do me no harm. Let's sing it again. Gonna hide right under the rock. I'm going to hide right under the rock. I'm going to hide right under the rock. I'm going to hide right under the rock. Where the devil can do me no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm. No harm, no harm, no harm, no harm. No harm, no harm. No harm, no harm. Where the devil can do me no harm. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
The devil can do you no harm.
Yeah.
Life is not mine. To you I belong. I give myself to you. My life is not my home. My life is not my own. To you, Lord, I belong.
Yes.
I give myself to you. See, it's very good to just trust God. Don't read, don't sing out of the books. Just sing out of your heart. You see, I always want to practice that so I can get connected. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
2 Samuel chapter 5, verses 1. Pardon me, 2 Samuel chapter 3, verse 1. Scripture says, now there was a long war between the house of Saul and the house of David. David was the king, David was a servant of Saul at the time. Saul was the king. So David was under Saul at the time. But being that as it may, David often did so many things by the grace of God that kind of made the king, Saul, to be envious of David. So there was a long war between the house of Saul and the house of David. But David grew stronger and stronger. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And the house of Saul grew weaker and weaker. If you are on the Lord's side, you will always get stronger and stronger.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse chapter 5, verse 10. chapter 5, verse 10. So David went on and became great, and the Lord God of hosts was with him. I see you getting great.
Amen.
You will become great.
Amen.
Said David went on and became great, and the Lord of hosts was with him. One can be great in size, you can be great in wealth, you can be great in riches, you can be great in wisdom, you can be great in power, you can be great in influence. But one thing I know, in this month of greatness, you shall be great.
Amen.
Because God was with David, he went on in life and became great. The G factor is the one that you need that will make you great. And that is God. What about greatness? In Psalm 71, I read verse 20 and verse 21. Scripture says there, thou which hast showed me great and sore troubles shall quicken me again and shall bring me up again from the depths of the earth. Let's read from that New King James Bible, verse 20 again. You who have shown me great and severe troubles. At times, if one has not missed the way, you don't get to know your purpose in life. I'll say that again. At times, if someone have not missed his way, you don't discover your purpose in life. Somebody once said, he said, men did not crucify Jesus. It was God that allowed men to crucify Jesus. Men has no power except the power of God. John said, no one can receive anything except it be given to him from above. You who have shown me great and severe troubles shall revive me again and bring me up again from the depths of the earth. That was the song of David. Yes, it is true that you have been penalized for what you have done. It is true that you fell before you can stand. It is true that we all make mistakes before we find the right person. But guess what? There's revival coming your way.
Amen.
For the scripture says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Look at the next verse. The same man that won restoration, that was so optimistic that God will raise me up again from the depths of the earth. You shall increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. Somebody's greatness shall be increased.
Yeah.
That shows you that there's no limit for you. That means that greatness can be increased.
Amen.
Whatever you have today, wherever you are today, whatever you have achieved today, is not the finale. I see you becoming greater.
Yeah.
I said, I see you becoming greater.
Yeah.
So David acknowledged. He acknowledged in that verse 20 that, Lord, though I have made mistake, you will raise me up again. You will bring me up again from the depth of the earth. He used that word again twice. You shall revive me again. You shall bring me up again from the depth of the earth. Except you are optimistic, that situation may not change. And in this month of greatness, I'm going to discuss with you what will cost you to become great in life. David acknowledged that with every level of influence a leader has, comes a peculiar challenges that comes with it. It sounds like saying for every new level, there's a new devil. In Genesis chapter 26, verses 12 to 15. Genesis 26, verses 12 to 15. Then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. Remember the G factor to your blessing. Remember the G factor to our greatness is God. The next verse. The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. Can you see what I'm saying there? I read from the King James Bible. And the man waxed great and went forward and grew until he became very great. Can you see that greatness can increase? He was great and he became very great. I see your greatness being increased.
Yeah.
That no wonder David said, you will increase my greatness. Because David knew that whatever you have today, whatever you become today, is not the end. There's always a room for improvement. Amen. Verse 14 of the same Genesis 26. For he had possessions of flocks, possessions of herds, great store of servants, and the Philistines envied him. Until his greatness, the Philistines did not envy him. When he became great, very great, the Philistines began to envy him. New level, new devil. New level, new devil. For every greatness, there are challenges. I want to discuss with you today the cost of greatness. Verse 22. And he removed from there and digged another well. Because at that time, in those days, just like in the Old Testament, you see, there are no banks like today. The source of revenue or income then was different from today. In those days, there was farming, agriculture, even though we still have them today, but they were not the main one today as it was then. So well, water was powerful. Water, anyone that can dig well in this in the desert is a rich man, you see? So that was where Isaac and his father became very prosperous. And he removed from there because the Philistine envied him. There's nothing wrong in you moving on from where people have criticized you. And he removed from there and digged another well. Everyone say another.
Another.
There's always another chance for you. Don't give up on the last mistake that you made. And for that, they strove not. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They have been striking with him, striving with him. They have been fighting him, contending with him. But this particular one, he got there. And for that, they strove not. And he called the name of it, Rehoboth. And he said, for now, the Lord has made room for us and we shall be fruitful in the land.
Amen.
This is your greatness.
Amen.
Troubles cannot stop your greatness.
Amen.
Rather, troubles will support your greatness.
Amen.
Do you understand that?
Yes,
troubles are not sufficient enough to stop you from being great.
Amen.
Troubles are supposed to strengthen us. For David said, for you are with me, even though I walk through what? Valley of shadow and of death. I shall not fear, for the Lord is with me, isn't he? For thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Psalm 23, verse 4. For you are with me. Troubles cannot stop your progress in life. So don't focus on the troubles. Focus at the end of your destiny. Focus on what is awaiting for you at the head, not what is there before you get to the end. Does that make sense? Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The rod, The scripture talks about the rod in the Bible, about spare the rod and spoil the child. So in other words, the rod is like for correction, isn't it? When we miss it, the rod will just kind of direct you, bring you back on course. So even in those days, they recognized that there's a role for the rod. See? But David said, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Does God correct us with rods? Yes. Yes, at times, because the pain you go through, you know, the money you do not have, the things that did not turn out the way you expected, you see, those can be rods of correction. You see, in Luke chapter 12, let's read from the New King James Bible. Luke chapter 12, verses 47 to 48. And that servant, who knew his master's will, and did not prepare himself, or do according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. So God is saying here, if you and I, we know what is the will of God, we know what is the mind of God, we heard it from the pastor, we read it from the Bible, but we refuse to do it. Did not prepare himself to do according to his, to the master's will, shall be beaten with what? How many stripes?
Many stripes.
Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Times the rod will bring comfort. See? No wonder David said, it is good for me to be afflicted when I was young. See? The next verse, verse 48. For he who did not know, see, yet committed things deserving of stripes, shall be beaten with few. So it's one thing for you to know and not do, is it? But even if you don't know, and you say you're a Christian, and you are doing things that deserve to be punished, God says what? You will not be spared. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. For everyone to whom much is given, from him, from her, much will be required. The truth that you know will be required from you to perform. You cannot know the truth and hide it. The truth that you know, God expects you to make use of it. Except because God will ask of you. For everyone to whom much is given, from him, much will be required. You don't know something and keep quiet. You don't know something and then, because you don't want to offend people, you keep quiet. You don't want to offend them, but you're already offending God. And to whom much has been committed of him, they will ask the more. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The costs of greatness. So the rods of correction are there to direct us, to correct us. How can a young man cleanse his way? Psalm 119, verse 9. By taking heed according to your word. So the word of God also corrects us. The word of God also redirects us from the wrong path to the right path. The bishop that does not know that homosexuality is evil, he has not studied the Bible properly. Because it's written there in Romans chapter 1. And now the bishop that knew what was written in the Bible and was still not preach it, and he said people should understand, you'll get many stripes. Because no one can escape the judgment of God. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. The word of God corrects us. Now you found out it's in the Bible, so let the word of God correct you. That is it. At times, we have to swallow up a bitter pill because the truth is bitter. Greatness comes at a cost. For the prodigal son, the scripture made us understand that He missed his way. Remember the story. He missed his way. He spent all that his father gave to him. Then he came into lack. And then God used that opportunity for him to come back to his senses. In Luke chapter 15, verse 21. The scripture makes us understand, and the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Rather than shrugging things off and pretending that God understands. God doesn't understand. You are alive today to hear this message. God expects you to be accountable for your sin. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Many should have given up their clergy doing. Why? Because of the fact that God has already sacked them. But they refuse to go. And now, the same shame that you are trying to avoid is just a matter of time. Your shame shall be seen by the whole world, and you will go eventually. Next verse. Well, the father said to his servant, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. The man was being decorated. Why? Because he paid the price. He was courageous enough to account for his sin. He came back to his father. He acknowledged it. Many of us who want to be great without paying for it. This man, the cause for greatness for him was the courage that he had in coming back home, returning to his father. For some, the enemy of their greatness is pride. Pride will not make that clergyman to honor. Pride will not make that woman to honor. Pride will not make that man to honor. But the day will come whereby your shame shall be exposed. For some, the enemy of their greatness is pride. The scripture makes us understand in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 18, pride goes before fall, before destruction. Look at it. Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit, a proud man, an arrogant spirit before a fall. Just a matter of time. In Proverbs chapter 29, verse 23, man's pride will bring him low, but the humble in spirit will retain honor. Anyone that acknowledges the sin will become honored, will become an honored or honorable person before God. See? But a proud man, God himself will bring him low in the name of Jesus. Amen. So, brothers and sisters, don't let us be proud. One common enemy in everyone who has tasted position of influence before, one common enemy in everyone that has tasted this before is pride. 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 They remember the Lord's glory. They remember when things used to be fantastic for them. Now, when they now look at their positions now and the influence they still command among people, they don't want to lose that level of influence. But that level of influence has already been lost. Only that it has not yet been revealed. It is called Ichabod. The glory has gone. Amen. Amen. The glory has gone. May that not be your own portion.
Amen.
Amen. But so the cost of greatness is that we must do everything possible that God wants us to do, that is in line with the word of God, so that God himself, the G factor, can promote us. In Acts chapter 3, chapter 5, we know the story of the couple, Ananias and Sapphira. In verse 3 of Acts of Apostles chapter 5, the scripture makes us to say that after they have sold all what they had, and they've agreed that they will bring the proceeds back to the church, Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back part of the price of the land for yourself? He came and he pretended. Pride made him to pretend that this is it all. This is what I've sold, and this is the proceeds out of it. You see? After all, pride will make him to say that, after all, it's all my things. They all belong to me. So I have the right to give any amount that I want. But you see, some people are not honorable. Why? Because they've rescinded upon their words. And God has taken note of that. It was pride that made him to lie to God. He would say, yes, it was my land in the first place, and I sold it, and it's up to me to give whatever I want. After everyone have agreed to bring the sales, pride made this couple to withhold as agreed. When people hold back their offering, they are being disingenuous to God. They are being wicked to God. Because God himself would not have asked you to give what he himself has not given you. Given to God, therefore, is an opportunity to honor God. It's an opportunity to appreciate God and thank him for what he has given. Because God loves a cheerful giver. So your rod and staff, they comfort me. If the rod of God correct us and redirect us, the staff of authority is his presence. For every presence of a king, of a royalty, there is always a staff of office that is there. Now, when you talk about the staff of God that correct, that comfort us, that is his presence. His staff is his presence. The scripture I've said in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 and 6, for he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Verse 6, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear. What can man do to me? So that's the staff of God. His presence. Do you know that he has said he will never leave you nor forsake you? So if you are a child of God, God is always with you. That is why the new covenant is better than the old covenant. The New Testament is better than the Old Testament, because the presence of God is more real than in the Old Testament. The presence of God is with us. Definitely, evidently, assuredly, in the New Testament. Wherever you go, say, wherever you go, he will stay with you. Say, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Unlike before, in the Old Covenant, the heart of God represents the presence of God. And wherever the heart of God is, that's where the presence of God is. In a way, it appears that the presence of God in the old covenant was limited. Amen? Unlike now in the new covenant. For we are the temple of the Lord. Hallelujah. And his presence is in us. Amen? So God is in us. Everywhere we go, God is there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the cost of being great is for you to deny yourself of anything, of everything that will rubbish the greatness of God from your life. The presence of God comforts us in everything we do. We cannot practice the awareness of God anywhere we go. Talk to God, the invisible God, yet his words are not invisible. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You can talk to that God and he will reveal himself to you. The scripture says the manifestation of the Spirit is given to profit all of us. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. So God's presence, God's Spirit is with us. Hallelujah. Everywhere we are, his presence is with us. And that is what David was saying, that his rod and his staff, they comfort me. The word of God and the presence of God. The presence of God today in the New Testament is marked by the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit of God. And so he said, his word and his Spirit, they comfort me. If God promised never to leave or forsake us, whose report will you believe? So, in your house, God is there. In your car, God is there. In the loo, God is there. When you're having your bath, God is there. In your kitchen, God is there. Practice the presence of God. Talk to that invisible God, yet his works are not invisible. If you find it impossible to believe God's word, then unbelief will become your enemy that will rob you of God's greatness. Number two enemy, in addition to pride, is unbelief. Unbelief is a thief of God's blessing. Unbelief is a thief of God's blessing. Mary and Martha had lost their only brother. Remember the story. He died from sickness. He died a premature death. John chapter 11, verses 20 to 24. John 11, 20 to 24. Now Martha, as soon as he heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. This was a sister that lost her brother. But Mary was sitting in the house. Next verse. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here earlier, my brother would not have died. Delay is not denial. Amen. Delay is not denial for anyone that believes God. For God, the time of the miracle is in the hands of God. So if you believe God to the end, and you will get the miracle. Amen. Next verse, please. But even now, he has said, if he had been here earlier, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. That was the word of who? The word of who?
Mary.
Next one, verse 23. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Jesus said to this woman, your brother will rise again. She had already said, if you had been here earlier, my brother would not have died. But Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Jesus is saying presently, your brother will rise again. Amen. The word of God is applicable to your present situation. Amen. Now, the next verse, please. Martha then replied to him. So it was Martha she was talking to. Martha replied to Jesus and said, I know that he will rise again in the future. But Jesus wasn't talking about the future. Jesus is talking about now. It's easy for many of us to believe God for something in the future. But it's difficult for us to believe God for now. The word of God must be appropriated to your present situation. If you are still thinking it's going to happen in the future, you have missed it. And this is where a lot of Christians are missing it. Because they think that the word of God is futuristic. The word of God is not futuristic. Yet, it might be futuristic in some. But in most cases, the word of God is now. The scripture says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1, now is faith. It didn't say tomorrow is faith. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1, now faith is. It's now. If the word of God is not in the present tense, it is of no good to us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The word of God is your effort, is your diligence that will make sure, that will make you be competent enough to appropriate the word of God to your life now. So that's why Bible study is very good. You must look at what is God saying to me now. It's not that I know God will heal me. God has healed me. And I believe the word of God. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
The cause of greatness. Unbelief has been the one robbing us of God's greatness. Unbelief has been the one robbing you of God's greatness. Unbelief, if you allow it, will rob you of God's greatness. It doesn't mean that God doesn't want to heal you, but it means that you are the one that is unbelieving God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Many of us find it hard to believe that the word of God can be applied now in our situations. The beauty of God's word for any one of us is to apply it now in our situation. Do I get an amen?
Amen.
So that John chapter 11, verse 25 to 26, back to matter. Matter that was futuristic. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. Remember the woman said, I know you will raise us up in the resurrection, the last days. Not in the last days. God is interested in your well-being now. God does not want you to die penury. In penury. He doesn't want you to die without penny. Hallelujah. God wants you to make it and be fulfilled. I don't know which God you are talking about that says that holiness is, it rhymes with penury. No. God doesn't want you to be poor. I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health. 3 John 2. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So let's change our mindset. God wants you to be to prosper. At the same time, he wants you to be godly.
Amen.
He said about Isaac, Isaac went forward. He prospered, isn't it? And he became very great. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. If you are finding it difficult to believe God for now, that is unbelief. If you are finding it difficult to always see God in the present tense, that's unbelief. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. Blind Bartimaeus came to Jesus in Mark chapter 10. Everybody knew blind Bartimaeus. He was always begging from verse 50 to the end. He was always begging, begging, begging that the man by the roadside. But on this fateful day, when he heard about Jesus, he pumped up the volume. He began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Many people think that making noise is cultural. Making noise is not cultural. It is passion. Passion is what makes you to make noise to God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So this man began to cry out. He said, Jesus, son of David, have mercy upon me. And Jesus heard him. Jesus has already gone past. And Jesus Christ stood still and commanded him to come. And the man threw away his garment and ran to Jesus. And then he got to Jesus and said, Jesus asked him, one of the, some people will say it's the dumbest question. Jesus Christ asked him, what do you want me to do? I thought you should have known that I am blind. No. Presumption is a sin. Don't presume that God knows. Even though he knew your condition. When he asks you, he says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock, it shall be opened. For everyone that asks, you see. For everyone that seeks, they find. For everyone that knock, the door is open. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 and 8. So, he said, ask. You have to do the asking. Even though he knew your problem. Hallelujah.
Amen.
At another time, he met another man by the pool of Bethsaida in John chapter 5. This man, from verses 1 to 5, has been in that condition for 38 years. Lying there. And he knew what to do, but he did not do it. Because he was people dependent. He was waiting on people to carry him when he can crawl, when he refused to crawl. And Jesus Christ saw him lying there. And he knew that he has been in that condition for such a long time. Many long-term chronic conditions are not because God doesn't know about it. It's because we refuse to do something about it. When you don't walk by faith, you are walking by sentiment. God is not a sentimentalist. God does not sympathize with you. God expects you to walk by faith.
Amen.
Unbelief is a thief of God's blessing. Jesus Christ knew that he has been in that condition for such a long time. And Jesus Christ was forced to ask him, gentlemen, what shall I do for you? What do you want? That's another question that you think is a dumb question. No. Jesus Christ was asking because there are many people that are sick today that doesn't want to be healed because of benefits. In badges, disabled badges in UK, that's why some people try to come to UK, isn't it? Because you can use those badges, isn't it? You can park on double yellow line, isn't it? You can't do anything with it. So even if you are praying for people to be healed, they will turn the prayer back. Who wants to be healed? So that was why Jesus was asking, gentlemen, do you want to be healed? So that question was not dumb. It was appropriate. Until you speak, God will not say he knows what you want. You have to say it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then they asked the man, do you want to be made whole? What will that be your answer? Yes. After 38 years of misery. You don't need any rocket scientist to tell you the answer. And then they asked the man, do you want to be made whole? In John chapter 5. He didn't say yes. He didn't say no. He was parabolating. He said, sir, I have no man to take me into the water. Because before I got there, somebody else stepped on me. So he can really move, but why didn't he move? He can crawl, but he wasn't crawling. He was people dependent. So God will not do what he knows you can do for yourself. Rather, God will do what he knows you cannot do by yourself. Hello?
Yes.
Am I too fast?
No.
Anyway. The cost of greatness. Where are we? See, I've left the phone we're talking about. We've gone elsewhere. That is the presence of God. For you to understand the scriptures, that you cannot play act. It has to be your life. So back to that John chapter 11. Jesus said to her, remember this one? Remember this one? I am the resurrection. That was an answer to that woman that was futuristic. Find it difficult to remember now. Matter. I am the resurrection and life. I know. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. God sees the end, not the present one. So see yourself, see your destiny. Don't write off yourself by where you are. No. English says, the downfall of a man is not the end of his life, isn't it? Hallelujah. Amen. So don't write off yourself because you are still going far.
Amen.
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 The next verse, please. And another, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Jesus asked the woman, Martha. Verse 27. So she said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is to come into the world next. And when she had said these things, she went away and secretly called Mary, her sister, saying, the teacher has come and is calling you. Well, the good news about that is that we got to the end of it. She eventually believed, and you could see that she paid the price. See, the unbelief almost cost her the death or the failure to resurrect her brother. Did you get the picture? Because at one stage, she was deeply in unbelief. But Jesus Christ came to the rescue. Even though Jesus Christ wanted her to appropriate the word of God, the Jesus now that you see to be the resurrection, to raise up your brother from the death, but rather you are saying, yes, I believe in the last day. So it is, the onus is on every one of us to look at the word of God and appropriate it into our lives. In Mark chapter 9, as I begin to round up, Mark chapter 9, you're getting something out of this.
Yes.
Mark chapter 9, the scripture says of another man, he had a child that had a dumb spirit. You see? And then he came to Jesus' disciple that he should cast out the dumb spirit, but then the disciple could not cast the dumb spirit out. Mark chapter 9, verse 20 to 22. Then they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him. He fell to the ground, wallowed, foaming at the mouth. Next verse. So he asked the father, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. The longevity of the problem is not because God isn't concerned. The longevity of the problem at times might be because you are not passionate enough to get it, to get rid of it. The next verse. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, if you can do anything, that's a very strong power. Prayer. If you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Next verse. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, Jesus Christ is telling somebody here, if you can believe, all things are possible for him that believe. That's what is on the wall there. If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Next verse. Immediately, the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Many a times we have unbelief, but we don't want to admit it. We have unbelief, but we don't want to admit it. And until you pay the price of casting away the unbelief, you might not achieve the miracle you want. So it is possible to be in church and yet still be in unbelief in your heart. Because this man came to Jesus. He saw Jesus in front of him, and yet he has unbelief in him. Did you get that? So it's possible to still be in church as you're hearing me, and yet to be full of unbelief. Even though you know that it's possible for God to change your situation, but you don't believe that God can change that situation. And every time you try to believe that God can change your situation, you doubt, yourself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Am I speaking to someone? Unbelief will rob you from being healed. Verse 25. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to him, deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter no more. That is the same way we should handle any demon-possessed people. You command the demon in the name of Jesus to come out. It's not for you to doubt, what if it didn't come out? It's not your business. You do what is appropriate and let God do what is needed. Next verse, please. Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, came out of him, and he became as one dead. So many said, he is dead. Last one, next verse. But Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. The cost of greatness. It will cost you to deal with pride and unbelief. The last enemy of greatness, in addition to pride, unbelief, is irreverence. Irreverence or lack of fear of God. The scripture makes us know in Proverbs chapter 1 verse 7 that the fear of God is the beginning of knowledge. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. In verse 5, the scripture says, a wise man will hear and will increase in learning. What makes a wise man, the difference between a righteous man and a righteous man, is the fear of God. While the fear of God will make the righteous man to do what is right, the lack of it, the lack of the fear of God, the irreverence of God in the one that is unrighteous will make him to struggle and not do the will of God. Where do you belong? It takes a righteous man to fear God, to remember God's word, and act on God's word. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Proverbs chapter 9, verses 9 and 10. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 9 and 10. Give instruction to a wise man, and he will be still wiser. You see? He will be still wiser. Teach a just man, and he will increase in learning. Next verse. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When we talk about this fear, it could be a negative fear or positive fear. But this fear we're talking about is a positive fear. That is the reverence of God. You know, you can walk up into a church. I can come to your house. You can come to my house. And then the moment you get to a room or environment, you can know whether the people there fear God or not. If I came to your house and you are watching pornography, I know instantly there is no fear of God. But if I came to your house and you are doing what I too would love to do, serving God, praising God, being happy in the night environment, then I know that you have a fear of God in your house. Do you have a fear of God?
Amen.
Because these are the things that will cost you to be great. You have to have the fear of God. You have to have the fear of God. You have to deal with pride. You have to deal with unbelief. In Psalm 68 verse 11, the last one, Psalm 68 verse 11, the scripture says, the Lord gave the word, as you are hearing them, the word, the Lord has given the word. Great was the complaint of those who proclaimed it. Do you want to be great? The Bible says, it is when you proclaim the word, when you act on it, when you don't just hear, but you do, and you tell your friends about the word of God, that's proclaiming it, said you shall be great. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The cost of greatness. And so, Father, we thank you for the entrance of your word that give light and understanding to the simple. Is there anybody here that have not yet known the Lord? Talking about lack of fear of God, you don't fear God. Talking about pride, you are so proud that no one can talk and make it play with you. Talking about unbelief, yes, you say you're a Christian, but you doubt the word of God. You don't believe it. Every time you pray, you yourself know you don't believe it. I want you to pray. If you are there, I want you to commit yourself to God and ask God to forgive you, because unbelief will rob you of God's blessing. Unbelief is a thief of God's blessing. Pride will rob you of God's blessing. Pride is a thief of God's blessing. In the name of Jesus. Lack of fear will rob you. Fear of God will rob you. Lack of fear of God will rob you of God's blessing. Lack of fear. Irreverence to God will rob you of God's blessing. Do you want to be great in life? Do you want God to make you great? Therefore, commit yourself to God and ask God that, Lord, all these three things, help me, oh God, not to condone them in my life. Lord, all these three things, oh God, help me, give me the grace to overcome them, so that the greatness that I desire in my life will come to me. Greatness in my job, greatness in my family, greatness in the church, greatness in the community, greatness everywhere I go. Even my family shall be great, because Isaac was the son of Abraham. Abraham was great. Even Isaac was very great. Let's pray to God. Let's pray to God that, God, help me. The word of God that I've heard right now will not come against or stand against me in the day of judgment. Lord, we bless you. If you are here and you have not yet known Jesus as your Lord and Savior, why don't you ask him to forgive you of the sins that you've committed, and you want to make a clean start with God. Ask him to forgive you. Ask him to save you. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior. With the heart, man believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Simple as it is, talk to God. Through one man's disobedience, sin came to the world. But yet through one man's obedience, we have the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, that we may reign